Hey everybody, this is my 1992 set of Donruss baseball cards. It was a big set that year. It takes two binders to hold them all. That is my cat, Maximus. He's gonna hang out with me. This is binder number one. I'm gonna be removing the best cards of the set. In the 1990s, baseball cards were overproduced. That makes them, for the most part, worthless. They take up a lot of space, so I'm going to get rid of most of them. Going to keep Kenny Lofton. But I'm going to go ahead and tell you what was going on in 92. And I'll do that while I pull these cards, the ones that I'm going to keep. So Oakland Athletics outfielder Ricky Anderson snatched his 1,000th base of his career. It was in the first inning of the A's win over the Detroit Tigers. That's why his card is, one of the reasons why his card is so collectible. And Nolan Ryan of the Texas Rangers struck out his 100th batter that year. And it was the 23rd year in a row . Also that year, Ryan Yount of the Milwaukee Brewers reached the 3,000th hit of his career. It was in a game against the Indians. But he also became the second player in Major League history, behind Willie Mays, to record 200 home runs, 200 stolen bases, and 100 triples. Yount, one heck of a player. Also that year, Andy Van Slyke of the Pittsburgh Pirates. He became the first outfielder in nearly 18 years to record an unassisted double play. He made a running catch in shallow center field. And then he was able to catch up and tag Ken Caminiti, who was running from second base on the play. Los Angeles Dodger Kevin Gross dominated the mound tossing 99 pitches. Of those were for strikes. And you guessed it. That game was a no-hitter against the San Francisco Giants. And Eddie Murray of the New York Mets. Well, he beat Mickey Mantle's record for the most RBIs ever by a switch hitter. In that year, Tom Seaver and Raleigh Fingers were elected into the Baseball Hall of Fame. Pete Rose, who was, he's ineligible to be in the Hall of Fame. He was banned from baseball for allegedly betting on games. Well, he still received 41 write-in votes. So there are people that think Pete Rose should be in the Hall of Fame. Also in 92, the commissioner of baseball was a guy named Faye Vincent. In that year, he ordered a realignment of the National League. He wanted to move the Chicago Cubs and the St. Louis Cardinals into the Western Division. The owners didn't like that. And they voted 18-9. To call for Vincent's resignation. And so Faye Vincent stepped down, and baseball's executive council rescinded Faye Vincent's order for realignment. Also that year, baseball held an expansion draft. It's what you do when you need more players, when you have new teams. And that draft resulted in 72 players being selected to fill the rosters of the National League's two newest teams, the Florida Marlins and the Colorado Rockies. So you want to talk some statistics for that year? Getting on base from balls, Barry Bonds led the pack. I guess the pitchers were just afraid to pitch to him. So he got on base a lot just from balls. Gary Sheffield had the highest batting average that chair at 3:30. Means he was basically hitting one out of every three pitches. Andy Van Slyke had the most doubles. He had 45. And Andy Van Slyke also tied Terry Pendleton of the Atlanta Braves for the most hits at 199 each. The most home runs that year, Fred McGriff with the San Diego Padres. 35 home runs. On base percentage in 92. Barry Bonds with a .461. So nearly half the times he went to the plate, he ended up on base. RBIs, you know, runs batted in. Darren Dalton of Philadelphia. He had 109 that year. Then when it came to just runs, Barry Bonds had 109. So Barry Bonds' slugging average was .624. Came to stolen bases, Marquise Grissom of Montreal stole 78 bases that season. Deion Sanders had the most triples that year. You remember Neon Deion played for the Braves. 14 triples. Let's talk about pitchers for a minute. In the National League, Terry Mulholland had the most complete games. You know, he had 12 where he pitched complete games. And when it came to ERAs that year, Bill Swift with the San Francisco Giants, 2.08. Lee Smith, the pitcher for the St. Louis Cardinals, had the most saves at 43. David Cone and Tom Glavine. Cone playing for New York and Glavine for Atlanta. Well, they tied for the most shutouts at 5 each. John Smoltz for the Atlanta Braves had the most strikeouts at 215. And the two National League pitchers that had the most wins that year, Tom Glavine and Greg Maddux. Maddux and Glavine were practically unstoppable. And they had 20 wins each. It's amazing. That definitely helps account for the Braves' 98 wins that year. And the 92 Braves were a fantastic team. And they made it to the World Series. But the Blue Jays beat them in a 4-2 series. But there were a lot of good teams that year. When it comes to individual stats, or team stats, I should say, the New York Mets were the best when it came to getting on base from balls. And the St. Louis Cardinals that year were the best team when it came to batting average. As a whole, the team had an average of .262. And I'm talking National League right now, but the Cincinnati beat. Cincinnati had the most doubles that season, 281. And the St. Louis Cardinals had the most hits at 1,464. The Atlanta Braves had the most home runs at 138. Cincinnati had the best on-base percentage, .331. Pittsburgh had the best slugging average that season, .388. And the St. Louis Cardinals had the most stolen bases with 208. And when it came to pitchers, Philadelphia's pitching staff racked up the most complete games with 27. Atlanta had the lowest ERA, 3.14. And when it came to the fewest hits allowed, Montreal had 1,296. In talking about fewest home runs allowed, well, that was the Dodgers at 82. Fewest walks allowed, St. Louis, 400. Cincinnati had the most saves. Atlanta had the most shutouts. Cincinnati had the most strikeouts. On May 17th, 1992, Gary Carter became the third catcher in Major League history with 2,000 games caught. Bob Boone and Carlton Fisk were the other two. And on July 27th in the 92 season, the Houston Astros go on this long road trip of 26 games. And they had to do that because the National Republican Convention was held in the Astrodome. So they had to hit the road and stay away for a while. And in September of 92, Barry Bonds joined the 30-30 club for the second time. At that point, there were only a handful of other players to accomplish that twice. That was his father, Bobby Bonds, and Ron Gant of the Atlanta Braves, Willie Mays, and Howard Johnson. But yeah, baseball, a lot of things changed a lot since the days of Willie Mays and Howard Johnson. Especially the money. I mean, these days, what's the minimum salary is like? Over $500,000 per season. That's just a minimum. I think the average salary is like $4 million a season. Thank you. And the players do get pensions these days. I think the average pension's about $43,000 a year. If you played 10 years in the major leagues, you probably have a pension of at least $100,000 a year. Of course, you know, a lot of players played baseball before there were such things as pensions. And a lot of those players played until they just couldn't play anymore. Like Satchel Paige. He played until he was almost 60 years old. Satchel Paige was a pitcher, and he was very good. Joe DiMaggio said that Paige was probably the best pitcher he ever faced. But we're kind of getting down to the end of this first binder. Like I said, the 92 Donruss was a huge set, 700 and something cards. It takes up two binders, and this was just one of two. Let me know if you found this video to be interesting. If you want to see the second binder, tell me in the comments. But until then, that pretty much concludes pulling out the best cards from this binder, which weren't many. But I do appreciate you guys watching. And until then, take it easy. See ya.